So we're almost starting. It's 9 o'clock here in the Netherlands in the European summertime. Sorry for all the confusion that caused. Time is relative, as you know. So for us, it's still 9 o'clock, but something changed. And the weather is improving. This weekend's going to be nice spring weather here, although that's, of course, a bit tricky with the corona situation. So we hope that everybody will not crowd in the cities and in the nature reserves and those places, but just do a lot of GIS at home, of course, to keep us healthy. So GIS is healthy, as you can see. So what do we have for you today? It's the third session, and we're going to cover spatial analysis with map algebra. So a lot of raster stuff that will go on. Before we start, and still some people will enter, I'll go through some slides where we'll introduce ourselves to the new ones, and then I'll show what the plan is for this evening, and then we'll start doing the practice. So if you are just attending in the chat, you can say who you are, where you're from, and yeah, anything else you want to share during the whole webinar, you can use the chat box to ask your questions, and we'll answer them. Kurt will do it while I'm demonstrating. And in the end, we'll of course have our geo beers where you can interact more with us. Okay, so I'm Hans van der Kwast. I'm a senior lecturer at IHE Delft Institute for Water Education. My background is that I'm a physical geographer, and that I did my master's at Utrecht University, also my PhD. And during my PhD, I was working already a lot with GIS and with Python. I was integrating satellite images in soil moisture modeling and looking at patterns of soil moisture in mostly in Morocco, but I also did fieldwork in Spain. And then I started working as a researcher at the Flemish Institute for Technological Research, that is in Flanders in Belgium. Had a great time there with a group of enthusiastic researchers, and we were starting to build up the open source tools in the unit. We started even a Python user group and shared knowledge on using Python. So it was a great time. I was working there on land use change models, a lot of GIS work. In the unit, we also worked on air quality models and water quality. And since 2012, I work at IHE Delft as an institute, which is a little university specialized in water. And there I give GIS classes. I'm a board member of the Dutch QGIS user group, which just started last year. And my interests are obviously open source GIS and also open source modeling tools. Like Kurt, I'm also a QGIS certified instructor, which means that if you follow classes with us, that you get the official QGIS certificate, which contributes 20 euros per certificate to the QGIS project. And that's a win-win for the participant to have an official certificate, for QGIS to have some income to benefit the software, and for us as an institute to help QGIS further. Other interests are remote sensing for hydrology. That's an important part of my work also at IHE with the water accounting and water productivity group. We also give trainings for FAO, for example. In my projects, I work a lot with spatial data infrastructures, help organizations to set up, to share data, to learn about open data, also the value of data and the value chain. I've been teaching those things also in the past days to environmental sciences students at IHE. Hope some of them are attending now. They're doing a great job. Today we were covering, and yesterday also, catchment delineation. And now over the weekend, normally they're a bit free in the weekend, but now in the corona times, they can use their time to delineate the catchment of their choice. So I hope they come up with very nice results. Of course, they're using our book. We'll talk a bit more about that later. Also, I like a lot doing field work. Behind the computer is, of course, nice and do the analysis, but you also really need to understand the processes in the field, and especially understanding how measurements are taken and the monitoring is done, and how to use that data in a proper way in your models and your tools. So if you want to know more and want to be in touch with me, you can always send me an email or connect through LinkedIn and follow the stuff I do, or Twitter and Instagram. And I have a YouTube channel that you probably know about, where I post regularly videos. And the more I'm at home, the more videos there will be over there. So probably more updates in the next days and weeks. I'll hand over to Kurt.
Hi, everyone. I'm Kurt Menke. I'm based in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and I run my own GIS consulting business named Bird's Eye View. And I also have been working with another initiative called the Q Cooperative. And that's an umbrella organization I set up with myself and five or six QGIS developers and power users. And collectively, we are trying to offer QGIS support services. So you can find me at Bird's Eye View or at the Q Cooperative. And just a little on my background. I've been working with QGIS since about 2005. And I've been teaching with QGIS for the last 10 or 12 years. And I use it in my business on a day-to-day basis. So I'm kind of a mix of consultant, educator, and author. I've authored six books on QGIS at this point, the latest being Discover QGIS 3X. And that's a big 400-page workbook that is a very thorough treatment of all the analysis and data visualization and cartographic capabilities in QGIS, also data management. And as Hans mentioned, I'm also a QGIS certified instructor. Right now, I don't have anything online. I saw that question, but I am working on getting some online courses up that would be QGIS certified. And Dr. Von der Kwast is doing the same. So stay tuned for those. And yeah, I'm definitely a Phosphor-G advocate. I think I think it reduces the barrier for entry into GIS. And so I'm definitely kind of promote the democratization of technology and think open source is very important from that perspective, as is open data. So that's an introduction to me. You can find me also on LinkedIn and Twitter at my handle GeoMenke.
Thanks, Kurt. So this webinar is one of a series of seven webinars. In the first one, we addressed preparing data from hard copy maps, and we learned about digitizing in GeoPackage format and a bit of styling of those vectors and labeling. Last time, we covered importing tabular data spreadsheets into QGIS and do spatial interpolation. We discussed even two of those interpolators. And today, as said, we will cover spatial analysis with map algebra, more in the next slides. Next time, we will have like the masterpiece of GIS for hydrologists, that's stream and catchment delineation. Then, once you have delineated your catchment, you also want to add data to your catchment. And these days, a lot of data is available on the internet. So in the fifth session, we will cover adding open data from OpenStreetMap and web map services to your catchment. And then, you also want to do some analytics. And in the sixth webinar, we will dive into vector processing tools and dealing a bit more with the attribute table to calculate the percentages of land cover per subcatchment. And then in the last session, we also want to have nice maps of what we all calculated, like the one on the cover of the book. So Kurt will, in that session, guide you through all the nice stuff that QGIS offers for styling and making your map in the print layout. So that's the full package, and basically that follows each chapter of the book QGIS for Hydrological Applications. And it's really useful to have the book next to the webinars and follow the steps while we go along. Those steps are far more detailed than we can cover in the webinar. That's more like a demo. There are lots of other videos that I have around, but the book really illustrates every step very nicely, and there's additional information and links in there. So if you're interested in the book, you can go to the website of Locate Press, so locatepress.com/hip, and there you'll find the book. Also, the book that Kurt mentioned, Discover QGIS 3.x, great book. I can really recommend that. If you want to know all the ins and outs of the current version of QGIS, then that's the place to look for it. Okay, so for today, we're going to do spatial analysis using map algebra. Map algebra is a technique. It's already quite old that was used and is still used to deal with raster data. I will not cover much of the theory, so I can really recommend to watch the video on raster analysis on my YouTube channel, which covers all the principles and the concepts of map algebra and the data types of rasters. I'll cover a bit of that, of course, today, but if you really want to know the details, then that's the video to watch. At the end, I will show you where all the supporting materials can be found, because we have now a little website for this webinar where we collect all the stuff. So what we will do today is we work with a case study. And the case is that we have an imaginary place, so it doesn't exist in reality. It's an oasis. We called it Ain QGIS. It's in Morocco in the desert. It really doesn't exist. And that municipality wants to assess which wells in that area are unsuitable for its inhabitants based on three conditions, so suitable or unsuitable. So wells are seen as suitable if they are within 150 meters from houses or roads, if there's no industry, mine, or landfill within 300 meters of the wells, and the wells should be less than 40 meters deep to be considered accessible. And for this task, we have a few raster layers, one with buildings, one with roads, one with elevation, and we have the groundwater level in the wells, in levels with reference to the sea level, so absolute levels of the groundwater. Now, there's a little anecdote about this data. I'm still figuring out if we can get a good story out of this, but this data set I've been using during my own studies, but it's much older. So at Utrecht University during the GIS classes, already going back, I guess, to the early 90s, they used this data set. But then during the development of exercises, they of course changed. And one complaint of my students was with the artificial coordinate system that it had in the past, it didn't really have a coordinate system. That it was difficult for them. So therefore I moved it to a desert in Morocco and named it then after this area, this oasis. So this data set is interesting. It's still used. And what we will have in the end is this map. So this is the end product of today's webinar, where we can see which wells are suitable here in green, together with a label with their depth, and which are unsuitable based on those three conditions that we have. So let's get started. I've started here at QGIS, and the first thing I'm going to do is I'll go to the browser, and I have a folder with these layers, the folder webinar. And the nice thing about the browser, so you'll learn also a few new features of the browser, is that you can make a folder as a favorite. So I don't have to scroll through all my folders here, and I can just stick to the favorite here on top. And we're here in chapter 3, and I've got these four layers. And the first thing that is wise to do is to check the metadata of these layers, because we just got this from this municipality, and we want to know what it is. If we click right and can go to the layer properties, and there you can find the projection here, the EPSG code. We can find the units, we find the dimensions, so 60 rows and 60 columns, that's what this means. We see the format, the geotiff. It gives here the statistics, the minimum and the maximum value, so that's very important to know. And the pixel size, 50 and minus 50. We can have different X and Y dimensions, but if they are the same, then it's 50 and minus 50, and it's square pixels. That's what we also cover here. For the rest, there's not much more information that's useful here. So this buildings layer has a minimum of 0 and a maximum of 5. That doesn't tell anything about the data type itself, so we have to figure that out a bit. Then we have the DTM. Similar projection and minimum and maximum range. So that's useful. Groundwater level, same projection, also good to know, because we can only do map algebra if it is in the same projection, if all the layers have the same projection. And then we have roads. Yeah. So I can add these layers from the browser. I select them and I can drag them to the map canvas, and here I have these layers. Now, QGIS and also other GIS desktop software automatically styles this, but based on nothing actually. So we see all these kinds of black and white legends at minimum and maximum, that is not really useful. So we really need to know what the data is before we can use it. And so therefore you need metadata, you need to know what it is. And the best thing to do then is to style the layers. So the first thing that we need to do, we have this criterion. If you have the book, you can read along. But the first criteria was, condition was to find the wells that are within 150 meters from houses or roads. So let's start to calculate the ones that are 150 meters from the houses. And therefore, I'm going to first style this layer, because this layer, rasters can have different formats. They can be discrete if they have classes, continuous if it's continuous data and they contain real numbers, and they can be Boolean if it's only true and false. And in this case, we have classes, so it's discrete. And each class is a land use in this case. So if you have discrete rasters, you go here to palleted unique values. That's one of the newer styling functions of rasters. It disappears now because we also have to click classify, and then it gives a random color to each of the pixel classes. And then we can modify it. So it's nice to mention that this palleted unique values option came into QGIS because of a crowdfunding. So people have funded this option if they found it useful. And it is very useful for styling discrete classes because it takes all the unique values from the raster and then we can give it colors. Now the legend of this map can of course be found in the book, but class number zero is none. So that's background. So I'll make it white. So you can use different types of looking at the colors or use your recent colors. I use the recent ones. And with this button, you just go back. Class number one is are the houses. Make them red. Class number two is public building. Make purple. And then three is landfill. A darker color would be more appropriate, something like that. And then four is industry. So remember that raster layers don't have attribute tables. So we can only store pixel values in the pixels, but not the class names. Therefore, we need to do this coding if we want to provide a legend later. Let's make industry still a bit darker. This one. And then we have here the mines. And make that one black. Here. So that's how you style discrete rasters. So we use palleted unique values. These are the values in the raster. These are the labels, and you set the colors. So that gives a bit more information. We are interested in the houses. So to calculate the distance to the houses, which is one of the conditions, 150 meters, I need to filter out the houses of this map. There are two ways of doing it. The first way is to use the raster calculator. Later I'll show another way of reclassification. So the raster calculator is what it says to calculate rasters, to do all kinds of operations with rasters. And I just double click on the raster layer's name. You see this at one, that means it is band one. In this case, these are all single band rasters. But if you have remote sensing images, for example, you can have map stacks where you can point them in the raster calculator to a specific band. And to just get out the class house, I need to specify the class number of house, and that is one, and then just do the equal. So I say building equals one. That's a conditional expression. It basically says if the pixels in building equal value one, so they're houses, then return me one, which is true, and return me zero for all those other pixels that are not true. So the output of this calculation is a Boolean layer. So I go from a discrete one, that's this input layer, to a Boolean with true and false. This then what I will call houses. There it is. The rest we keep as default. This is just if you want to modify the extent, and I just want the same extent as the input. So I click OK. And then we have this map with true and false. And then it's still good practice to also style that one. Boolean uses the same renderer as discrete because it's still classes. It's just a specific type of it. So it has only two classes, 0 and 1. So I go to paletted unique values and I click classify. And the two classes are classified. Now I want false to be red and true to be green, because that's more intuitive. If I later want to combine it, I want to also visualize this in a clear way. So 0 means no houses, and 1 means houses. So that's step 1. We have now the pixels that are houses, and now I need to calculate 150 meters around those houses, because that's the condition for wells to be accessible. So to calculate those distances, we need the raster analysis tools, and there we find the proximity tool, raster distance, and we get this dialogue. And there, make sure that the input layer is indeed houses, and we're going to use as distance units the georeferenced coordinates because it's in meters. And the nice thing about this tool is that there's an option to indicate already the maximum distance, and that's what we want, because we want the maximum distance to be 150 meters. And we want all those pixels that apply to that distance to get a value true, so that will be 1. And all the others will be 0. And then basically in this one step, we calculate and the distance, and it converts it to a Boolean layer, which has true for all the pixels that are less than equal 150, and 0 for all the ones that are further away. Now we have to change this output data type because it's Boolean. So we need the byte output type, which means only zeros and ones. And then I can give here the output map. And this will be houses 150 meters, TIFF file, another raster layer. You see that it runs a Python GDAL proximity script to calculate this. So there it is. And we see this. And again, I want the ones to be green and the zeros to be red. So I can simply copy the style from houses and paste it here. And there we see in green all those pixels that are close to houses. The houses themselves are red. And also the areas outside the 300 meters buffer, the 150 meters buffer, correct? 150 meters buffers are red and have the value 0. If you are ever in doubt which values are green or 0, you can also use the identifier tool and click and then check. And there you find then the values. So 0 and this is 1. Yeah. So that's always useful to do if you want to check the outcomes. Now we need to do the same for the roads because we also need to be 150 meters from roads. Now let's have a look at this road map. So I'll move it to the top. There you also see that rasters are difficult to combine, huh? Because I now moved roads to the top and I can't see what's below. So that's very important that you keep an eye on the orders of your layers. And there I want to calculate 150 meters from the roads. There are two road types here apparently. So I'm gonna style it using the paletted unique values. And I click on classify, and this one is no road. This one is dirt roads. This one is tarmac. So let's make no road also white. And then dirt roads. Oops, we make it something like yellow. Not very clear, but it's okay. And then tarmac, something like black. So you have the different road types. And I just want the distance to roads. That's the condition. So it doesn't matter if it's dirt or tarmac. So I'm gonna do again the raster calculator. And now this one then would be roads, and can do it in different way, but I think roads larger than zero, that will mean one or two will be true and get value one, and all the other pixels will get zero. I'm gonna save it and I call it isRoad.diff. And then I do okay. And I can still paste the colors, paste style there. So the roads are in green and the no roads are in red. Of course, I need to modify the text here. So roads and roads. And then again, 150 meters. So also that's repeated. Analysis, proximity. And there, don't forget to put it on georeference coordinates. Also 150 as a criterion. And then one and zero. And the output will be byte. And then I call it roads150.tiff. Okay, and then I paste the style. And again, rename it. That's then larger than 150 meter. And this one is larger or equal 150 meter. So it's clear. Let's also we'll adapt this one. So this one was larger than 150 meter from houses. And this one less than equal 150 meters. Okay, so that was condition 150 meters around houses and roads. Then condition number two is no industry, mine or landfill within 300 meters from the wells. So we need again our map that we created before with these buildings, but now I want to isolate the landfill, industry and mine and give them the value one to be true and the others value zero to be false, and then calculate 300 meters from the industry to be true. So these are some different methods that we're going to use. So I'm going to open the processing toolbox, and before I continue, I'm going to change a setting, a default setting in the processing toolbox. I'll explain why. Here under general, there is a default setting, prefer output file name for layer names. Normally it's switched off and it needs to be switched on. So make sure that if you do this exercise that you check it, because otherwise if you do several times a certain toolbox function, it will output the name of the algorithm. Well, it is more clear if you every time get the name of the file in the layers panel. So by checking this box, you will get the layer name as the file name and not the name of the processing tool that you used. So that's a setting. So I'm going to do a reclassification. Reclassify by table. That's the one we are going to use because I'm going to make a lookup table. So make sure that here you use the buildings layer, and I'm going to make this reclassification table. So I'm going to click here, and we have six classes, including the zero. So I add six rows, and then we fill in the minimum and the maximum. They are the same because you can also use these tables to reclassify ranges. In this case, the input is already discrete. I need to put zero, of course. So class zero remains zero. That was no buildings. And class one is also zero. These are the houses. Class two, public buildings, also zero. Then we have class three. That's the landfill. That needs to be value one. Class four, sorry, no typos, also one. And class five, also true. So this is a lookup table. where basically we reclassify each of the discrete values to 0 Boolean and 1 Boolean. Do OK. And we need to change some settings here. These range boundaries are important. So in our case, the minimum and maximum are the same. So we need to put it on the less than equal for both ranges that are in the first two columns of the lookup table. So it really uses the value. So that's important. There are some other settings, use no data when no range matches value. We cover all the values, so we don't need to change that. And then the output is again byte. So that's basically what we need to do for the reclassification. And then I can save the reclassified raster to a file that I call industry. Yep. Let's run it. Hopefully I didn't make a mistake here. You can see the summary of what it did in an almost graphical way. So that's very nice. And click close. And the output is here. It was where your cursor was, it will put the layer. So because I changed that houses legend, my cursor was there, therefore the output layer is put there. So I need to drag it to the top to see it. And then I again paste the style. So, and rename it. No industry. And industry. There we are. And the next thing is that I need to calculate the distance from the industry, because the condition is that suitable wells are at least 300 meters from the industry. So at least 300 meters from the green pixels. Now, when we do this proximity tool, we could set a maximum distance, but not a minimum distance. It is the inverse. So we can do this in different ways. In GIS, there are always different solutions. But what I will do is I will calculate all the distances. So we get a continuous map with all the distances to industry. And then I'm going to use a raster calculator to select the distances that are larger than 300. So I need to put it on georeferenced coordinates. I now don't fill in the maximum distance and these things. I just want all the distances. So the output is a floating point. And then I'm going to save the file and I call it indist. There it is. And then I run it. And I get this layer. So now we don't have a discrete or Boolean output, but we have a continuous layer. And we need to style it as good practice. So if you want to style continuous layers, so the definition of continuous layers is that it can have real values. So it can be decimal, like this one. And it is things that are gradually changing in the landscape. So for the styling of continuous layers, we use single band pseudocolor. And then we can use ramps. There are many ramps offered here. And let's see if we find a suitable one. If it's further away, it's better in this case. So something that goes from red to green. Yeah, so closer to the industry is bad and further is good. So from red to green, that's one option. Now the next step is to select those pixels that are further than 300 meters. I just check if it was equal in the example that we used or not. Larger equal. So, well, I guess you know it by now. We do raster calculator, also in this case, and I use the indist, and then I say larger or equal than 300. Also, always check if the expression is valid. And this means if the pixels are larger or equal than 300 meters, then give it Boolean 1, true, else give it 0, false. So I call this industry 300 meters .diff, save, and I run it, and I get this nice one, nice piece of art, would be a nice print on a t-shirt. And then I style it, paste the style, and and this is less than 300 meter, and that is larger or equal 300 meter. So that's condition number two. Now we have one more condition. Condition number three is we need to look for wells that are less than 40 meters deep. Now what I have here is a layer with the groundwater level. So I'm going to put that on the top. And basically this layer, let me just hide all and I'll show that one. Basically this layer gives us the elevation of the water level compared to the reference, which is sea level. Now to get the depth of the well, we need the elevation of the surface, which is in the DTM. That's this one. Now, as a good practice, let us first style the DTM. The DTM is a continuous raster. So we need single band pseudo color. And then we can choose a ramp. And a bit of a hidden secret is if you go to create new color ramp, and you can go to CPT City here, that's a catalog where you can choose all kinds of presets for ramps. And I go here to topography, and I can use here, for example, the SDA one. And there it is. And another nice trick that we will also use later, next time in the catchment delineation and the styling of that, is we can duplicate this layer. And there's a special renderer for hillshade here. And it looks now very blocky because they're very large pixels in a small area. But if you choose here the resampling and you put it on bilinear, then it smooths. And if we now combine the DTM with the hillshade, let me also just rename it, also good practice that we know what we are looking at. So hillshade. So the hillshade is not calculated, it's the DTM, and it's just rendered by the hillshade renderer. And now I put the DTM on the multiply blending mode, and then we can see a bit more relief effects there. So that's a quick way of doing that. I'm going to style the groundwater level. Now these are just pixels at locations with the wells with the level of the groundwater. It's continuous data because it has decimals. So single band pseudo color also here. And I would say the deeper, the more red. So another nice trick here is that you can invert the color ramp. And now these are deeper wells than the yellow and the green ones. So now we have styled it, and basically what we need to do to calculate the depth of the well, so from the surface to the bottom, to the water level in the well, we need to subtract both. So also there, I use the raster calculator. And this is the surface level, the DTM, and I do minus. You see that I also click those things because then the if you click those buttons, the syntax is better and you can't make mistakes. Minus groundwater level. You can, of course, type this, but then you have a risk of making typos. It says it's valid. Then I save this one to well depth. And I run it. And now we get the values relative to the elevation of the surface. So I'll style it again, single band pseudo color, invert it. And of course, the same results in terms of colors. And now the criterion, the condition was to look for wells less than 40 meters deep. Now that becomes simple then. Raster calculator, well depth. And then, depending on what you want, you can do less than or less or equal. But I'm going to use less than here, like in the book. And then 40 meters. And I'll call this one not deep, dot diff. And then I run it. And I can paste the style because it's Boolean again. So the green ones are the not deep ones, and the red ones are the deep ones. And I'm going to style it. always good to do a check. So what I'm going to do is use this and check if this one really is what we want. So not deep, zero. And if I then go to this one, then I see indeed that it's deeper than 40 meters. So it's always good to check these things. So you can choose the layers for which you want the results, or you say, I want all the layers or a selection of layers, so you can play with it. Okay, now we have the three conditions independently evaluated. Now we need to combine all these in one map where all the conditions apply. So we have the selection of the wells that are suitable. So I go also to the raster calculator here, and there we use so-called Boolean logic. So you see these operators, and or. And means that all the conditions need to be true to give the output map a value 1, which is true. If it's or, it means that one of the two or both need to be true. There are some other ones that we use in Boolean logic, like exclusive or, then they always have to be different. And not, which is the inverse. So there are a few of those that are mentioned in my theoretical video. So the first condition was larger or houses within 150 meters. So let's so that's not this one. That's of course the condition, houses 150 meters. And roads 150 meters. And industry 300 meters. So further away than 300. And not deep, this one. So these are, this was the first condition, roads and houses 150. Second one, industry 300. And not deep. So what it does, it's going to evaluate all the zeros and ones in those rasters. And if a raster has in all these maps a one, it will get a one in the output. In all other cases, it gets a zero. So I'm going to give the output name that's accessible. I think we chose here as the example. Yes, accessible wells. And I run it, and there it is. I style it. And what we see there is that just these three wells in the corner are accessible, and the others are not. And let me just also change then the legend. The problem is that this is raster, and it is not really the nicest way to present this to the end user, the municipality in this case. So what I'm going to do is to convert the raster to vector. And if you go to the tools here and you see conversion, then you can get polygonized. But these are points. We don't want polygons. So we need to do this in a different way. And therefore, we use a tool from the processing toolbox. And that tool is raster pixels to points. So if I just look for points, I find, of course, a lot, raster. Then there's under vector creation, raster pixels to points. That's exactly what we need. If you do the polygonize, every pixel will end up in a 50 by 50 meter polygon. That's, of course, not what we want. So in this dialog, you have to point to the right layer. And you can give the name of the attribute of the field in the attribute table that the pixel values will go to. And that one we will call accessible. And it will get a zero or a one from the raster. That's basically what this tool does. It takes the center of the raster. I'm going to save it to a file. Stop a video of somebody. Okay, and I'll save this one as accessible as wells. And then I run it. that's very quick. And I see now the points of the wells. So I'm going to hide a few layers that we're not going to use now in the visualization. Keep the DM. And now we have our points there. And if I look in the attribute table, I find there the zeros and the ones. It's a bit strange that it has all these decimals, but of course the computer doesn't know that it's Boolean. But this is still what we need. And what we can do also is add the other data to this point file. And that's another thing that is handled in that chapter, which is very useful. So what I actually want, I want also the elevation of the surface. I also want to know the distance to houses, etc., on all these points. Now, how do you do that? Therefore, we use a certain tool, which is called the point sampling tool. And you can install it, manage and install plugins, and look for the point sampling tool. This one, in my case, it was already installed. And I'll demonstrate how it works. So you get this icon, and it detects the vector point layer that we have. So that's wells, so it automatically selects that. And it puts here all the layers that you have switched on. So if I want more, I have to switch them on. You can also do here now, show all the layers. And then if I use the tool, you can then see them all in here. And what I want is a few of these layers. I want to know the well depth. I want to know the groundwater level. I want to know the DTM. I want to know if industry was in 300 meters, the exact distance to industry, roads 150 meters. The house is 150 meters, and I can save it here. I'll choose a shapefile in this case, but we all know that, of course, the geo package is better. And I call this wells data or something. So it makes a copy. And what's important is you can also go to this fields column and fields tab, and there you can fill in the names of those columns that you want in the attribute table. You can change this one in elevation, for example. Then I do OK, and it creates the layer. And if I look at the attribute table, then I get all that data sampled at those points. So I know for each point then the value of the different criteria and the distances, etc. It's a very useful tool if you want to sample on points. OK, now I want to style this. So I'm going to hide all the layers, and I just keep, let's keep this one. And the DTM here. Let me check if this one also had the good and the bad ones, the ones and the zeros. No, it didn't. So I should have added that one. So I'm going to use this one, the wells, because I only want to visualize. I also want to visualize the elevation of the wells. So let's do this step again, so you can also see it. So I'm going to remove this one, the one with all the data, because it's missing the data from the depth of the wells, which I also want to visualize. So it doesn't have the true and the false combined with the depth of the wells. Let's just do it again. It's very quick. So I have to switch them all again. Point sampling tool, and because it makes a copy, of course it doesn't add it to the existing one, so you need to select this one, the wells accessible, and we need the depth of it, so the well depth, that's this one. And for now I leave the others out, so you can also see how that works. And fields, I just call this one depth, and I'm going to output it, and I call this wells with depth. Okay. So I get now if they're accessible or not, and I get their depth, and that's what I would like to present to the end user, the municipality in this case. So now it's time to do the styling. And I'm going to show you a few new features that are described also in the book. So go to the layer styling panel. And first of all, I want to make categories. So I choose here categorized. And we use the categories from the accessibility, if it's one or if it's zero. I want to show that. And then I click classify. So I get zero and I get one. And I get this all other classes. That's if there's no data. So it's not one or zero, then it belongs in this class. It's always added in the renderer, but we don't need it, so we remove that one. And now I want to change the colors. So you can double click on the color, and I want to make this one red because it's false. And I want to make the other one green. And I make it a bit bigger, four. And I have to hide a few layers here, otherwise it gets a bit confused. So until the DM, everything that's below the DM cannot be seen, except that with the distance calculation, maybe we lost a layer here, or the DM is a little bit smaller. The next thing that I'm going to do to make the visualization better is we can go here to the layer rendering. And I'm going to use some of these draw effects. So I switch on the draw effects. I go to this button here, customize effects. And there you can give all kinds of effects to your points layer in this case. I want to drop shadow. Here it is. The source one is of the original data. So if I switch it off, I only see the shadow. So if you keep the source on, you can get these other effects around the original point. So in this case, I do drop shadow. And if you click on then that effect, you can also change then some parameters. So I'm going to make the shadow a bit smaller, maybe. Maybe use their value of one. And now we see that. So that's very nice to use these effects. Then we need some labels, because I want to show the depth of those wells. From the colors, the user can see which are accessible and which aren't. And then with the value, I want to show the depth. So I go here to the label engine, and I choose here single labels. And yeah, we want to show the depth, but that doesn't really look nice if we do it like this. So let me tune this a little bit. Let's first, make sure that we have all the information in there. So I go to this button here where I can add some functions. And what I first want is a string. And we learned last time that you put that in single quotes. So well depth. That's in single quotes. And I'm just going to remove this so we can see in real time what happens. So now the output of this is just well depth for every point. And I can add something to that with this button, can concatenate. And now I can add the well depth to that, but I want it on a new line. So I use this new line button, then it jumps to the next line. And I go here to fields and values. And I can add here depth by double clicking on it. And you see it uses double quotes there, but I forgot to concatenate. So you see the expression is invalid. And so I need to add. And now you see it also appearing here in the example. But this has a lot of decimals. So I also want to change the format of the number. So there are functions for that. We also used it in the beginning. So format number is a function. So I add it here. It opens a bracket. And it just needs the amount of decimals. So I add here two decimals. That will be sufficient for us. And there we see now 44.06. I also want a unit. So I'm going to add again a string. Put a single quote, a space, meters. And now it says well depth 44.06 meters. So that's what I want. So I do OK. And now we see it is implemented. Then I want to change a few things here. So I'm going to change the font to sans serif, for example, make it a bit smaller. And what I want is to change the placement.
The video ends a bit abruptly here because the recording ended, but I hope you enjoyed this webinar and looking forward to see you at the next one next Friday. where we're going to cover stream and catchment delineation.